But the big argument, or the body augmentation that tends to happen when boys go through the transition to become females, and when they have lived a life considerably for some time as a female, the nuances of females, the gestures, the mannerisms, things which are commonly associated with female behavior, they become blurred. Not so much for them, but for men, heterosexual men. And considering the improvements today with regard to makeup and just general appearances, the lines between identifying who is a natural born female and a transition female will become more and more difficult as time go by. Particularly when we do a lot of communicating in a virtual space. Right now on YouTube and other venues, but the metaverse is right around the corner. Knowing whether or not the person that you are talking to was born a female or was not born a female, it's going to be challenging. So I would say, as heterosexual men, when we engage women, it's necessary, vital, I would say, for us to use probative language to be able to elicit whether or not that individual is an actual female or was born a female, as opposed to being a transition female. And obviously, you want to develop a tactical way in which you communicate. You don't want to come off aggressive. You don't want to come off threatening. You don't want to come off insulting. And you definitely don't want to come off as though you're phobic in some way. But at the same time, you need to be able to assess what gender are you speaking to, literally. Now, in the common speak today, we know there's such a thing as gender expression. And gender expression is fluid. Gender expression is fluid. But your actual gender is not. So whether if you're male or if you're female, that's your born gender. But in today's world, someone could determine that they want to express themselves in a much different way. And when someone is expressing a gender that is not natural to how they were born, as a heterosexual man, you need to know what you're encountering. And one of the things I would say when you're trying to probe, to define or determine if the person is actually a female, because in this time and age, your eyes can play tricks on you, no doubt. What you see is not always what you get. So, for example, as you engage in a conversation, let's say, one of the key things I think, you know, and this is just my opinion, but I think depending on your environment, professional or social, you can tend to determine how you want to insert your probative language to determine who you're actually speaking with. How do you normally address someone when you would like to know whether or not whether that person is actually a born female, presenting their gender as female? Well, you know, one of the things that I think the trans community has really pushed forth, and I think in some cases the heterosexual community has kind of pushed back against that, but I think bringing up the subject of a person's pronoun and how they would prefer to be referred to, you know, what pronoun should I use when referring to you? And they might say, well, what do you mean? And you could say, well, she, her, or how do you prefer to be addressed? And I think a good way of asking a person what's their pronoun is a segue for you to get to the bottom line, for you to get to know whether or not they're actually what you see. You can easily say, well, I mean, did you transition, or were you always, were you born a female, or did you transition at some point in your life? And obviously that can bring up a conversation. They may ask you, well, why do you ask? Whatnot, whatnot. But I think it's important for us to be deliberate in our communication, because I think it's clear that the differences between men and women and their parent, I guess what we call the battle between the sexes, it doesn't seem to be subsiding. And I think women are going to fight all the way to the end. And if anyone have seen the Fox Soul interview with Dr. Umar, you know, in the beginning, I myself thought, hey, is that a real woman? I wasn't sure. But the fact that they did not brief him, either in the back chat, the host of the show, I think that was very disingenuous. And I think more and more people will look to set up some brothers. And more than just, I would say, a conversation. We don't live in a time where we can assume and make assumptions just by what we see, because assumptions can be completely wrong. You know, the old saying, when you assume, you make a fool out of you and me, is more literal than figuratively. I think one of the terrible things that this brings forth as straight men, it's important that we protect ourselves, that we protect and guard our self-image, because we know that some people will not always volunteer information for transparency's sake, so you can speak from a from a knowledgeable place, knowing the environment that you're in. As you guys come on into the stream, hit the like button. Let's bring the likes up, guys. So I just wanted to kind of drop that as a PSA for the men out there. I mean, I'm not sure. I saw the embarrassment of it, but I'm looking at it from a more deeper standpoint where it's one thing where you can be set up as a man and a woman or a trans woman may not disclose who they're speaking with, because we know that trans women and or gay men prefer straight men. And I remember back a few years ago, you know, even Cardi B said when she used to set guys up, she used to, you know, they used to go to the hotel and she would drug them. And then she'll switch up and have a trans woman come in and turn guys out, mess their head up. So they may be, you know, natural women who may look to set up heterosexual men with trans women. So I think, you know, understanding the dynamics of our society and the way people are moving, you can't underestimate anyone. And you have to keep your wits about you, whether you're in a virtual space or you're in, you know, in physical proximity in a meeting, or particularly when you're socializing, because socializing can present more damaging encounters. One, you could be videoed, which could definitely present a problem at some point. And in other cases, you could be just set up. So don't be afraid as men to bring the conversation up to protect yourself. You can't be concerned about maybe someone feeling slightly offended. As long as you take enough caution to be courteous and professional in your conversation and you're not being rude, it's a necessary conversation to have. I also want to talk about, for men, having standards. Standards and conduct of behavior. These things are real important. How one presents themselves. Yourself, your name, your self-image, your brand, your family, and most importantly, how members of your family represents the family name. And there's a reason why I'm going to touch on this. I'm going to bring up a video in a minute. But one of the things that have damaged us as a Black community, and particularly as Black men, is the destruction of family and the importance of the family name, something that once meant something to us as a people. For many of us, we believe just because we have money, we are deserving of certain things. But I say, no, not always. There are still many people who believe that your reputation precedes you. And what some of us, many of us, don't realize is that there are many families who understand that standards and reputations speaks volumes for who you are, and more importantly, who your family is. What's the name behind the person? One of the things I've noticed is that we have strayed away from a good family name, families that have reputation. And living a life with standards and living up to a standard is something that it seemed like very few people concern themselves with. How you present yourself. We see that so often with sisters when they're traveling, going to the airport, when they go on different lives. You know, they have these shower caps, hair bonnets on their head, and they think that's perfectly fine. Your image, and more importantly, how you represent yourself and your family's name, that's your brand.